Howdy, everybody. So there's going to be a lot of content. It's going to get fairly technical. I'll do my best to make it as plain as possible. But we're going to go into a lot of stuff, including bitmap indexing, hashing, data locality in Cassandra, the fanout used for search, and the IO path. And then hopefully we'll get into some performance tuning and GSE tuning. Anyway, let's jump in. So Cassandra, how does it work? It's basically a distributed hash table. In order for a distributed hash table to work, you need a hash function. What is the hash function? We talk about them all the time. In Cassandra, we use Murmur 3, but we've also used MD5. You hear about them a lot in passwords. What is a hash function? Well, the short answer is that a hash function takes in a variable string of bytes and it outputs a number. And that number is going to fall in a number range. In the case of MD5, it's 0 to 2 to the 128th, which is a really big number. That really big number is so big that it can encompass the number of particles in the known universe, so super, super, super big. What we do in Cassandra is that we will take this hash function and we'll take this hash range, the range from 0 to 2 to 128, and we divide it up. And we divide it up by the number of nodes in your cluster. So if you look at this diagram, the orange box, the outer box, is the entire hash range, and then each of these smaller boxes in the middle is each node. And so in this instance, I've got 4 nodes, and so I've got 4 sub-ranges, each assigned to a physical node. You can see that these nodes are distributed around the cluster. So in this instance, I've got a cluster of 4 nodes. Now, what happens is that I'm going to take my key for my primary value, I'm going to run that through the hash function. And that's going to determine which of these nodes it gets placed on. In the simplest, Cassandra is a key value store. A value may be a row or could be an individual value, but at the simplest, Cassandra is a key value. So how does this work? I can have multiple IDs mapped to the same value, right? If I wanted to do a lookup, what I would do is I would hash the value of the key, and then that would return the node that I'm going to find the value on, and then I go get the value. But what happens if I want to find all keys that have a particular value? So let's say I'm looking for all keys that have value V1. Well, because that's not being run through the hash function, I can't determine which node has my value, and I can't go to that node and go find it. And so what I end up doing a lot of the time is I create query tables where I will have a value, and I'll map it back to the partition keys. And so I have two tables, one that maps the primary key to the value, but then another table that maps the value to the partition keys, and the partition keys will be stored as a list of like ID1, ID2. The problem with this is that it gets really expensive. So each one of these is going to be contained as a string. So if I'm using a string, then the number of bytes required to store each value is actually pretty high. It makes it difficult to do complex queries. So let's say I wanted to do a query that said, give me all primary keys or give me all records that have V1 or V2. Well, I'd have two different lists, and I'd have to combine these two lists in memory, and that gets really expensive. These lists could be hundreds or even billions of items long. So what do I do? Well, I can compress this list using bitmaps. So what is a bitmap? Well, bitmap works by taking each value and assigning it a 1 or a 0 in the bit vector. So if we go back to slide 14, you can see I've got ID1 and ID2. Now, if I'm going to encode it in a bit vector, then ID1 corresponds to the first bit in this bit vector, and ID2 corresponds to the second bit, and then everything else is zeros. This means that the key that corresponds to bit 1 and bit 2 is set to on, which means they have the value V1. So you can see automatically I've gone from a string representation, which isn't very dense, to a bit representation, which is extremely dense. This is pretty much as dense as you can get it, until you get into run length encoding, which we'll cover a little bit later. So this is a way for me to compress the amount of information down into a smaller representation. And smaller in computers means faster. So one of the other cool things about bit vectors is that, let's say I wanted to do a query that said, give me all records that are that have a value of V1 or V2. Well, I would take the bit vector from the V1 index and take the bit vector from the V2 index, and I can do a bitwise OR, and that creates another bit vector called a candidate list. And so what do I mean by a candidate list? So if you look, I've got this top bit vector, 1, 1, and then a bunch of zeros, and then I've got the bottom one for V2, which is 0, 0, 1. And I'm going to do a bitwise OR. So if either bit is set in either these one of these bit vectors, it'll be turned on in the resulting bit vector. Now, this is effectively giving me an OR query because I now have a bit vector that represents value 1 or value 2. This is done extremely fast. You know, this is done as quick as my CPU can pull bytes from memory. So we're talking gigabytes per second in terms of throughput in terms of index computation. The other cool thing is I can, just using simple ands and ors, I can build up really complex queries. I can do simple stuff like Boolean clauses like this V1 or V2, or I can do really complex things like regex queries. The regex queries, actually I have a full hour-long talk from Cassandra Summit 2 years ago on how bitmap indexes work. But then also a good resource for how to go from bitmap indexes to regex is actually the Google code search paper. That goes into the nitty-gritty. But the key thing is that using these very, very simple principles, I can get really complex behavior. So one other thing that's important to note about bitmap indexes is, let's say I want to maintain the entire index in memory. Well, for going back to our bit vector for the V1 index, I just had two bits set to one, ID1 and ID2. If I was to maintain the entire index in memory, well, I'd have to have a total of 2 to the 64th bits in memory, assuming if it was a 64-bit index. And that's massive. It's gigs upon gigs of just zeros. So I would have 1, 1, and then a gazillion zeros. So what do? Well, we use something called run length encoding. Run length encoding works like this. I've got a signature byte at the front, which is my 1, 1, zeros, actually. So the 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0 is actually a raw byte. So that's a raw value from the index. And then what we do is we put in a string of bytes that is the signature, and then we put in a string of bytes that is the that signifies how many bytes after this are repeated. So in this instance, I've got 1 byte, which is raw, 1 byte, which is signature, 1 byte, which means 256 bytes of zeros afterwards. And so I'm increasing the data density within my index. And so it just makes it easier so that when I'm reading through this index, I can say, oh, the next gig of data is skipped because it's all zeros. It makes doing searches much, much faster. The downside is that they're really expensive to update. The reason being is I can't seek to a known place in the index. I have to read the entire index to figure out where to do my update. I can't just say, oh, skip to, byte 54. Because byte 54 may really be, bit position, 2048 in the index because of the run length encoding. So indexes, bitmap indexes that are compressed are quick to read, quick to query, but they're expensive to update. We're going to have to revisit that because that's going to feed into performance within Lucy. So how does search work, Michael? We understand some of the basic fundamentals. Let's take those fundamentals and apply it to an actual working system. So if you're to crack open Solr, or really Elasticsearch works the exact same way, what would it look like? Well, I'd have a JVM, and inside that JVM, I'd have Tom Caterjetti, and then within inside that, I've got a web app, which is Solr or Elasticsearch. Doesn't matter. They're both performing the same functionality. Then within that, I've got Lucene. Lucene is what actually does all the bitmap indexing. So if somebody's talking about a search solution and that search solution is written in Java, you're most likely using Lucene. So in this world, Lucene indexes the documents, stores the index data, all those bit vectors, in the index segment files, which is one set of files up here at the top, that slightly off green color. And then it stores the raw data in the document store, which is this purplish cylinder down below. So what happens when I'm processing a document, let's say for indexing? It's going to come through the JVM. It's going to be indexed by Lucene. Lucene's going to update the index segments, and then it's going to store the raw documents in the document store. What happens when I execute a search? Well, the same thing's going to happen more or less in reverse. I'm going to get my search query. I'm going to parse it. Lucene's going to turn it into all these sort of basic operations over the bit vectors. It's going to go fetch the index data from the segments. It's going to create what we call a candidate list, which is the final bit vector that says, all right, this bit set on, which means that document one matches your search. We're going to go down that bit vector, and then for each bit that's on, we're going to fetch the corresponding document from the document store and return it to the user. And that's pretty much how search works in all bitmap indexing implementations. It's really quite simple when you get into it. So how does it work in DSE? Actually, I'll come back to that slide. In DSE, we replace the document store with Cassandra. And so in DSE, the document store is Cassandra. There is no duplication of information. So within the JVM, you've got Tomcat, Solr, and Lucene, and then you've also got Cassandra. So how does this IO path change? So a document comes either into Cassandra or into search. It's going to be indexed. The index data is stored on the file system just like it would be for Elasticsearch or for raw Lucene or for Solr. But then the raw data is going to be stored in Cassandra, in the SS tables. And the reason why this is important is that Cassandra is a highly scalable, linearly scalable, fault-tolerant database. If you look at most of the search offerings out there, whether it be Elasticsearch, Lucene, Solr, they're not reliable. They're not designed to be highly available. They're not designed to be fault tolerant, and they're not designed to be linearly scalable. Cassandra took those as first principles. And so when you look at Elasticsearch, when you look at Solr, when you look at Lucene, what are the key downsides to using a solution like that? It almost always has to do with availability. So if I lose a node, I'm most likely going to lose some data, or some portion of my data is going to become unavailable for a portion of time. I'm going to have issues scaling across multiple data centers. I'm going to have issues scaling to really large data sets because it wasn't designed as a distributed system from the get-go. I mean, Elasticsearch is a little bit better, but it's not great. If you read the AFER blog post, it's really easy to make it lose data, and it doesn't scale across multiple data centers. Whereas Cassandra, I mean, that's what it does. And we took a system that was designed to fulfill all these needs, and then we added Search onto it. And so the distributed, the highly available, the fault-tolerant part of our system is much, much better. So let's go and talk about the shard router. There's one more and sort of interesting thing, and then we'll get into the I/O path and sort of performance tuning aspects. So inside of Cassandra, or inside of our search offering, one of the things that that's important to know, going back to data locality, is that when we're querying by something that's indexed, we're typically not searching by the partition key. And if we're not searching by the partition key, we don't have a value that we can run through the hash function. And because we don't have that, we can't ahead of time determine where the data lives. Like, which node does the data live on, and how would I query it? So data could really exist on any node. There's no way for us to know up front. There's no way for us to determine the data locality. And so what we do is we do something called the fan out. And all search systems do this, whether it's Elasticsearch, Solr, or whatever. What they'll do is when a query comes into the system, the shard router is going to look at the number of nodes in the data center, and it's going to say, hey, what's the minimum number of nodes I need to talk to in order to fulfill this query? Typically, it's going to be the number of nodes in the data center divided by the replication factor. If your replication factor is 3, it's typically going to be a third of the nodes in the data center. And so what third depends on a couple of different things, and this is one of the unique bits to DataStax Enterprise, in that we will, given all the replicas of all the tokens, we will assemble, right, here's the nodes that can answer for each range, for each token range, for each replica set. And then we will select the node that has the lowest latency, the lowest load, and the best overall health. And then we will send the query out to those nodes. Each node will respond with the data that from itself that matches the query. And then the coordinating node, the node that actually received the query, will stitch it back together and then return it to the user. And this is important for a couple of different reasons. The first is you can query any node in the cluster and you're going to get the same result. Second is that Cassandra has built-in load balancing, or DataStax Search has built-in load balancing. And it's because we're automatically balancing query traffic across the nodes dependent on node health. And so if you're using DSE Search, then the need for a load balancer, the need for intelligent clients falls away. Because you can ask any node in the cluster, just doing round robin across the nodes in the cluster, you're going to get the same results, and you're going to get even load balancing of load across the cluster. So if you look at the key benefits to DSE Search, it's going to be, because it's reliable, you can use it as a system of record, meaning you don't have to do synchronization between your primary data store, like if that was a MySQL or what have you, in Elasticsearch. That's a really common pattern. It's like I've got MySQL as my system of record, but MySQL doesn't provide search, and so I need to tack on Elasticsearch. In DSE, that's not true. Because you have highly available, highly reliable Cassandra, it can act as your primary data store. And then we're just adding indexing to that. And then if you've, and because of the built-in load balancing, you get to remove the load balancer. And so we've taken a system that has three moving parts and we've collapsed it down to just a simple, simple stack of just one homogeneous node type. So when you start to do that, it has a couple of downstream benefits. The first is that operations is going to be simplified and that operational costs are going to be lowered because you no longer have to spec out these clusters that can deal with peak load. You don't have to figure out backup solutions for multiple different technologies, things like that. So let's go back and start to talk about a little bit of I/O within search itself. So we're going to switch gears a little bit. We're going to talk about within search, what does the I/O look like? And talk about sort of the real-time nature of search and why how DSE differs from existing solutions built on those. So when I update a document, what happens is that that's going to go into Lucene. Lucene's going to perform a bunch of indexing work, and it's going to update an in-memory structure called the RAM buffer. The RAM buffer is just a way to batch up writes, because remember, updating an index that's run length encoding is expensive. So we're going to do a bunch of updates to this RAM buffer, and then we're going to encode it, and then we're going to write it down to the materialized files, which we call segments, or which Lucene calls segments. So in this instance, I've got my one RAM buffer, and I've got a bunch of different segments that represent the materialized index data. This is very similar in some ways to how Cassandra does things. Cassandra's got a mem table, which it uses to batch up writes, and then we've got SS tables, which are stored on disk. And both in Lucene and in Cassandra, the files on disk are immutable, meaning that they once they're written, they're never modified. We can read and create a new one, but we're not going to update a segment in place. Now, the one major difference between a RAM buffer and a segment, between Cassandra and Lucene, is that in Cassandra, the mem table is searchable. So if I update a mem table in Cassandra and I query for that value, it's going to come from the mem table. It's fast. It's accessible to searches. In Lucene, as a quirk of the implementation, the RAM buffer is not searchable. So when I execute a search, I'm only going to be searching against these segment files in orange. I can't see the updates that are in the RAM buffer. So the downside is that if I were rapidly changing a value in, say, Elasticsearch, and I were to fire off a search, the record may be returned because it hit the query, but if I look at the raw data, the raw data may not have a value that matches the query. Let's say I'm updating a document, I'm updating counters, and I'm updating from 2 to 3. If I fired a search for 2, the document would be returned, but it would be returned with a value of 3, meaning a document that didn't match the search was returned, and because it was returned, it had a value that didn't match the query. So it's the difference between the sort of visibility of search and the durability. So in Lucene, like years and years ago, to sort of deal with some of this visibility issue, they introduced a concept called the soft commit. And we've seen terminology, flushing the RAM buffer down to disk is called a commit, and they call flushing all the way down to disk a hard commit. So rather than fix the visibility issues in the RAM buffer itself, they just introduced an intermediate step. And this is called a soft commit. And so what they do is instead of flushing these segments out to disk immediately, what they'll do is they'll create an in-memory representation of the segment. And those will be soft segments. They exist only in memory. And so that allows Lucene to create these segments frequently to make them searchable. And then at a later point in time, we will do a hard commit, which is more expensive, merge them all together, and then write them down to disk. The good side of this is that I can be doing a soft commit every second, but the downside is that I'm going to be creating lots and lots of segments that are only in memory, and so that when I do a flush to disk, I'm going to have to merge all these segments together, and that's expensive. And I'm doing this all synchronously, indexing and stopping while I'm doing this. So fortunately, near real time is expensive. Now, there is an upside. The upside is that in DSE 4.7, we've introduced a new feature called real-time or live indexing. And in real-time or live indexing, it's referred to as both, so that's why it's confusing, but sorry about that. What we've done is we've taken this RAM buffer and we've separated it into different chunks using memory fences. And so each core in your system, each CPU core, gets its own chunk of the RAM buffer. And so we do that to, to increase the throughput of our indexing. Indexing throughput is now linear with core count, which is important. And the second thing that's important is that the RAM buffer becomes visible to search. And so if you were to execute a search, the updates that were pending in the RAM buffer become visible. So in DSE 4.7, we've more than doubled indexing throughput, and we've also made it so that the delay between something being inserted into the RAM buffer and become visible by search is really, really short. I'll just show you the graphs now. So you can see in this graph the difference between near real time, which is stock Lucene, and real-time indexing. So in this instance, this is number of documents this is the amount of time to index the same document set over core count. And so you can see the indexing time is going up with concurrency in near real time. And then with concurrency, it stays the same and stays low. And it's about as half as much as the traditional Lucene search. This goes to a tweakable within Solar itself, which is the back pressure threshold per core. So it, For those of you that have deployed Search in the past, this is one of the tunables that you'll often hear me or somebody else say to tune, which is if indexing starts going over certain, if indexing starts consuming more resources than would otherwise anticipated, kick in optimization, disabling soft commits. And the plus side is that by increasing this value, you can increase throughput, but the downside is that you're going to increase memory consumption, which can result in GC pressure. And in DSE 4.7 means that we can increase the indexing throughput without having a noticeable impact on garbage collection. And so, again, it's just we've doubled indexing throughput. Again, doubled indexing throughput. So, oh, that wasn't supposed to show up. I used these slides also for internal training that had internal links to benchmarks. So let's go back and we're going to look at some samples. So I'm going to share my screen. So for this demo, what I'm going to do is I took a data set that had that I got from Stanford that had all of the books from Amazon and all of its metadata. And I turned that into a Cassandra column family and I made it searchable. So here's the schema for my column family. You can see that I've just got a couple of fields as plain text, and then I've also got my categories and also bought as sets or collections within the Cassandra schema. And what happens is I'll insert the data into Cassandra, and then I'll run DSE tool create core. What that's going to do is it's going to create a corresponding search core for this column family. And then it's going to spin up Tomcat, and it's going to make available these corresponding URLs. So let me share my application. Okay. All right, so this is what Search looks like. So you're going to get the Solr interface, and in the Solr interface, you have a bunch of different functionality. When you're just starting out, you're going to want to play a lot with this query interface. So I'm just going to execute a basic query, which is this. And so I'm going to get in response each of the corresponding rows that matches the query. I have accessible to me pretty much the entire search functionality of Solr, which means I can do searches via a REST API, passing in parameters via the URL. One of the other cool things is that I can see this. This is my auto-generated schema. It's not a very efficient schema if you were going to for absolute performance or to decrease index size, you would want to tune this manually because we don't know what your data is. We have to make a lot of assumptions. Like we're in here, we're assuming that it's a Roman character set, that it's not kanji or Chinese, that that you're going to want to be doing full text indexing over all the text fields, which results in a really large index. So we in the auto-generated schema, we went for flexibility and not necessarily performance. But the search interface is really only one view into your data. In some ways, it's interesting, but it's not the whole story. We'll run one query and then we're going to switch to the command line interface. So let's see. I want to find a document that has this ASIN. So I'm executing the query, and I've got the one document that matched. And then I can also do things like, let's do title, science. So here I've got all books that matched science search. So I've got fuzzy search over really massive data sets, and we do it pretty much at scale better than anybody else. So let's switch to the command line interface and view something that's also unique to DSE. My turn. Okay. So what we're looking at here is just CQLSH. Those of you that are already running Cassandra in production are going to be very familiar with this. So I can do and I'll just do another one. So I've got my Amazon data set here, badly formatted because my font's really big. So let's run some more interesting queries like we were in an application. So normal Cassandra users will be used to queries like this, where I'm selecting my ASIN and title from my metadata repository, where my primary key might is equal to a value, right? Normal Cassandra query. How would we execute the same query via Solr? Well, when you're using DSE, what we do is we add this new functionality to the SQL query language called Solr underscore query. And in that, you can pass a search query to DSE. And so equivalent query using the Solr syntax where I'm passing the ASIN and the full value. Now, if I'm just searching by primary key, that's not particularly interesting because I can do that in Cassandra. Where it starts to get interesting is when I start doing fuzzy search. And one of the ways you can do fuzzy search inside of Solr is to use the tilde operator, which is this character right here. Boom, I've now got all books that started with 0000732119 as their ASIN. All right, so that's a little bit more interesting. What else can we do? Well, we can do facets. Now, a facet in DSE, or search in general, is a way to get statistics about data that matches your query. So let's fire off this query. So this query, let's go back up to it. It says select, the select doesn't matter. What matters is this facet part right here at the end. Facet colon field also bought. The reason why this is interesting is a facet will count the number of occurrences for a field that matched a query. So let's take a look at this data. You can see it returned a JSON structure where there's a key called also bought. And then if you look at each of these values, let's say 0022800352, this first value, it means that 73 books had in their also bought this ID. So it means this ASIN was the most popular add-on item for across the entire book data set means it was bought 73 times across all the other order types. I'm sort of curious, what is this book? So, select. individual. McGraw-Hill Science Grade 2. All right, so that is the most popular add-on item for all of books. And so the reason why facets is interesting is that you can start to build really complex applications. So where is a use for facets? First one, and this is probably the most popular, is catalog information. So I execute a search, let's say for solar underscore query equals, and I'll do title, science. Okay, returns a bunch of books. Now, what I can do is also facet on, let's see what's an interesting field to facet on. Categories. Categories, title. All right, so of all the items in my database that match a title of science, give me the categories. I can say there are 176 books in my search that match the title science, and one movie, one TV show, and then all the other categories are zero. And so if you think about the experience with Amazon, with Netflix, or with any other store or catalog on the internet, I execute a search, and over on the left-hand side, it's going to say, oh, you had, of your search, 176 of these were books. And I can say, refine this to show me only books or only TV shows. And so from it just gives you this really nice way to pare down your search results to something that's super targeted, something that I'm interested in. And the reason why I keep mentioning catalog is that we've got a number of very large online retailers that are using search to power their online presence. They're using DSE search for their main web presence, their store, their search, their catalog. So we're running a little bit out of time, so I'm going to hop around and do a couple of other interesting things. One of the other cool things about search is that it allows me to do joins in Cassandra. So I can say, give me the book that ranked number 16,057 in the Amazon rank. And so the way that this works is that I've got another column family called rank, which, let's do a limit one, that has the rank for each of the categories and the corresponding ASIN in also indexed. Now what I can do is execute, okay, there's rank. Here's my search query. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to, from Amazon.rank, I'm going to join where rank is equal 16057. That's going to return a primary key, which I'm going to feed into the query, saying return the metadata information for the primary key that matches my join query. Oops.
copy paste there. Oops.
That should be better. There we go. So in this sample, I've gotten the metadata for Collins English 30th Anniversary Edition, which is rank, which is the corresponding rank of 1605773 in books. And so this allows me to get around the limitations of no joins in Cassandra. I can use it by bitmap indexing. There are some limitations in that I can only return data from one column family at a time, but it does allow me to execute searches returning a primary key. Execute searches returning primary keys, which then are then used to fetch data from a different column family. So joins, but not quite SQL joins. Now, the other sorts of interesting things, and this is where we start to talk about what does it mean to execute search at scale, is that going to, I'm going to stop sharing for a moment because I'm going to show a slide. So if we go back to the slide deck, there's this search, this one right here. And this illustrates what I was talking about earlier, the fan out. So if I execute a search from the client, it's going to go to a random node. That node's going to act as a coordinator, and it's going to do a fan out to a number of nodes in the data center, dependent on replication factor and load and all sorts of other stuff. But typically, it's going to be the number of nodes in your data center divided by 3. And each node is going to respond with the data set that matches the query. It's going to be stitched together on the local coordinator and go back to the client. So this works for, you know, medium to small size clusters, let's say, you know, 100 nodes or something like that, which is a fairly sizable data set. We're talking, you know, we're talking hundreds of terabytes. But let's say I want to go to a really large data set, you know, we're talking petabytes or 1,000 plus nodes. But that fan out starts to get more and more expensive. Well, a lot of times when I'm executing search, especially for data sets that big, the data set is typically multi-tenanted. And typically, search is going to be limited to just the information for that tenant. So if you can think about, you know, email, right? Very rarely, if I were storing and indexing email in Cassandra or messages in Cassandra, am I going to want to search across everybody's email? I really want to target my search just for this particular user, and that's going to make up the vast majority of my searches because users are searching their own email. They're not searching other people's email. So what I can do is I can pass in what we call the routing key, and the routing key allows us to add some locality information back into the query and skip this fan out. And what we'll do is we'll just go to an individual node, and the overhead of search drops away. And that's done using a special syntax. Let's go back to sharing real quick. Condition, my term. And I can do route.partition and pass in the partition keys that I want to restrict my search to. And that skips the fan out. And so this is really important for doing search at scale. And it's an optimization that's present in DSE, but not necessarily present in other search offerings. And then the other interesting thing is lots of time in search, I just want to return the partition keys. And the partitioning, and what I can do is I can say, just go to the indexes to give me the partition keys and skip going to Cassandra to fetch the raw data. And so it takes what is a typically a two-step process for search, for really most search operations, and we turn it into a single step where we're only fetching the data from the index. So this can, if you're doing a lot of searches returning only primary keys, that can result in major speed improvements. I'm going to burn through a couple of quick slides, and then we're going to open it up to questions because we're getting close to the end. Okay. So the most important things in terms of performance is to decrease indexing size and really only index the fields that you need. You don't want to use dynamic fields. Really, dynamic fields or dynamic schema in Lucene is just an anti-pattern. I don't care if you're using Elasticsearch or using Solr, you don't want to do it because as a result, your index, each unique field in Lucene allocates memory on the heap, and then if you end up with millions of fields in Lucene, millions of actual indexes or unique field names in Lucene, you're just going to blow the heap. And this is true for Elasticsearch as well. And so Elasticsearch claims to have dynamic schema, but it really doesn't. And so the way that you can get a monitor it is using the Luke request processor in DSE. And then you can use joins to get around the needs for dynamic schemas or dynamic fields in Elasticsearch. You want to turn off term vectors, really all sort of the decreasing index size is almost a talk unto itself, but the deck will be distributed, so I wanted to make sure this was in there. The other interesting thing is inside of DSE, we've actually got the ability to do named queries where you can figure where we, for a named query, we keep statistics on the different phases, and we can tell you what the, you know, the 95th, the 99th, and the 999th quantile is for any single query. We also offer query tracing and slow query debug log and a bunch of other stuff. It's really important when running search at scale. It differentiates us from other search offerings. In terms of performance tuning, there's the 8150 tunings, Cassandra 8150, and this is tuning CMS. Tuning CMS is a lot of art, and it requires multiple iterations. Instead of doing CMS, what we're pushing people towards is doing G1 tuning, coming from Cassandra 7486. You get very, very close to CMS throughput, but it's much more reliable. It's less likely to go sideways on you. DSE 4.7 improvements, there's a lot. The main ones are going to be probably the live indexing. But there's just a lot of improvements in terms of throughput and running search at scale, because one of the things that differentiates us from the competition is that we have really large clusters. It's very common to have 1,000 plus nodes in a Cassandra cluster, whereas other search offerings can pop out in like tens of nodes, low tens of nodes. And competition, us versus DSE. Whilst the search, you know, you have to put a little bit less thought up front, but as a result, you end up with something that's not optimal, and then you're going to run into performance issues. Where with DSE, we make you put a little bit more thought up front, and as a result, you get a more performant system out of the box. The other thing that's interesting about DSE is that because it is reliable, it can act as your system record, which means that you can have a single system for all of your data, which isn't true for Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch is only good for search. And I need a primary data store, and I need an analytics story, whereas all of those come together bundled with DSE. And then the last point I want to make is that, so I was I was the first DSE customer back in 2012. Like, I was on the beta list. So I've been using DSE for a long time. And for my company, when we switched, we started off with a stack that was Postgres for the primary data store, so sharded distributed Postgres. We were using Hadoop, and we were using, for analytics purposes, machine learning, things like that, and then we were using Elasticsearch as our search offering. When I switched to DSE, I switched to essentially a single stack for all of my data, except for a little bit of billing stuff, and that's because I was lazy. But the vast majority of my data switched to pure Cassandra. And then that data set was indexed using Solr. And in that transition, not only did my stack simplify because I was getting rid of a bunch of other systems, so but I was able to increase my performance because Cassandra was faster than Postgres while growing my data set by 500%. And the as a result of these gain efficiencies, I was able to reduce my servers and I reduced my operational spend in AWS by 40%. And then I deleted 15,000 lines of code. And to me, the deleting 15,000 lines of code was the most, well, other than cost, but it's 15,000 lines of code does impose its own cost, which is in terms of maintenance and complexity. And most of that code was having to deal with synchronization between the multiple data stores. And because I was using a single data store for most of my needs, all of that code got deleted. And that was really important to me because it meant I could focus less on my database and focus more on application logic, which is what people were paying me for. So I didn't get to cover all the slides. I didn't get to go into performance tuning and stuff like that. But hopefully that gives you a pretty good overview. And I'm going to do, 5 minutes worth of questions. So I'm going to, of these questions, I'm going to do two.
We are right at the top of the hour, so there is not time for questions, but maybe you could go through the log and maybe either answer via Twitter or on a blog would be great, but we're not going to have time to go through them right now.
Okay. All right, so if I can't answer Q&A, I'm going to post the we'll post the slide deck and I'll tweet it. So follow me. I'm at Matt Stump on Twitter. I'll go through and I'll try and answer a bunch of your questions either in a blog post or on Twitter itself. And feel free to just reach out to me directly.